So my NAS has a problem. I guess I shouldn't say it's a problem. It's working perfectly fine, but I'm down to my last 100 megabytes of free space, which is like 1.2%. And ZFS does not perform well with 1.2% free space. So today I have some things to rebuild my production HOMELAB server. You guys know I run a lot of testing stuff on the box PC here. My production stuff has been running on a TerraMaster NAS, video up here on that. That works pretty well, but it's only got a dual core Atom, I think, or maybe Celeron. And it's got one NVMe and two drive bays. That's what I've been using. And it's got 12 gigs of DDR4, which is working fine. So I'm upgrading to this guy here. And this guy, despite having less RAM currently, I'm gonna order more RAM, don't worry. It's four drive bays, two NVMe, plus a dedicated boot SSD that I've already wiped. So I'll be able to have a mirror of SSDs in my ZFS pool, and also a mirror of hard drives here. And I got some bigger hard drives as well, so it's in that box there. So I'm going from 2 6 terabyte drives in a mirror to 2 16 terabyte drives in a mirror, with the option to add another mirror in the future, because I have the drive bays for it. So let's get on with this adventure. So over here on the old NAS Terra, I shut down all the containers and VMs. I'm gonna run a backup on each one. I'm just gonna add the pre-migration and we'll protect that. So we'll keep it for a long time and we'll back that up. I'm just gonna go ahead and do this for all of these guys so they'll all be on the backup server. These drives I got, they are Seagate Exos X18, 16 terabytes. So that's what's going in. And here we go. For this build, idsonix was kind enough to send over their new i5000 NVMe SSD, which claims a 5000 megabyte per second read speed. So I guess I'll have to test that. So idsonix has included this two-part heatsink for the drive. So there's a backing plate and a front heat spreader, as well as two thermal gap pads. The other one's the same. I'm actually not going to use this heatsink because the Ugreen NAS already includes an NVMe heatsink and thermal gap pads built in. So two slots in the Ugreen can do PCIe Gen 4x4, same as these guys. These drives are 1 terabyte each. I'm going to put them in a mirror, so the same data is on both drives for redundancy. That also means my read performance will be twice as good because of ZFS. I also bought more RAM to upgrade, but can't do that yet because it didn't arrive. I actually have enough space to use the heat sinks from idsonix though, because they're not that big. So this goes on both sides. They have two thin thermal gap pads. And of course, the thickness of the thermal gap pad affects the conductivity a lot. But I just don't think there's any airflow in this area. There's a big piece of rubber here to kind of seal off so screws don't fall around the area. So the thick pad to the case is probably my best option. So here's the TerraMaster. I got everything backed up, shut down. Now I just need to pull out the two drives in here. And I also need to pull out the Coral TPU that I use for Frigate. These guys have been with me for a long time, so I'm finally glad to retire them. I set them up for my very first NAS, I think in 2017 or 18. They ran FreeNAS back then, and the ZFS pool has been with me that whole time. And it's still going to be with me because we're going to move this ZFS pool onto the other drives, the mirror, and then delete these from the mirror. So this guy currently has, I think he's got 12 gigs of RAM. So there's a 4 gig stick in here that's kind of hard to get to. And then I upgraded the other stick to 8 gigs, so we have 12. I didn't want to take the other one out. And then I got my two SSDs here. One's actually the Coral TPU, and the other is a 960 Evo. There's a half terabyte. I'm probably going to keep it with it. But yeah, I'm planning on listing this for sale on my Ko-fi or maybe on eBay. I'm not sure. I don't really need it anymore, so I guess if you want it, I can sign it and sell it to you. Okay, so don't remember this guy from my video. He's got two and a half gig NICs, two USB 3s, and an HDMI. So, not super weak. New one has 10 gig, but it's actually only using 2.5 gig anyway to go to my desktop, so not a Huge deal. It's done with this one now. So ordinarily you just access memory and SSDs through the door here, but I'm taking out the Ugreen boot drive, and so I gotta disassemble this further. So on this guy, this access here is where the door is, so there's the two NVMe slots. I think these are both connected at PCIe Gen 4x4, I guess I'll see when I boot it up. This one is definitely connected at only Gen 2 though, which makes sense, it's for the boot drive. And then these two RAM slots, there's one 8GB stick that came with it, so 8GB is the minimum they sell. I ordered a 32GB kit 2x16, it didn't get here yet, and I really need this storage pool up and running tonight, so that'll get swapped in later. So again, because the boot drive has lower PCIe lane count, that's where I'm putting my Coral TPU. So there goes the Phison 128GB, and here goes the Coral TPU. It's also a little dangly thing here, and this actually pushes out the little door. So there's a door to get these, and the spring pushes it out. And I keep messing it up when I put the case on, so it's bent. But let's see if I can get that in right. Yeah, so that little thing there just kind of kicks the door open. So I'm not going to put the hard drives in yet. I'm going to install Proxmox with the installer. I'm going to select ZFS RAID 1 on the two internal drives. Then we get that up. Then I'll put the other drives in. So you guys probably have seen a Proxmox installer before, so I won't walk you through it. So I got Proxmox installed, ZFS mirror on the 1TB drives. I switched to the no subscription repo and ran updates. Now I got the four drives in. Let's get 2 16TB, 2 6TB. So this is a Z pool. I'm gonna expand the mirror to be a 4-wide mirror. Then I'm gonna remove these two disks from the mirror. And that will expand the pool up to the full 16TB. So let's turn it on and get started. Okay, so I got my boot pool, R pool. So I'm gonna import data pool. So that should scan all the disks and find a pool name data. Okay, so this is an older pool, so some features are unavailable. I will Z pool upgrade in the future. There are my two drives. So now I need to add the additional drives to the same mirror, mirror zero. So WD60s, so these are going to be the two that I have, and then the ST16, so A and B are going to be the new drives, and C and D are going to be the old drives. So that's the path to the old disk. That's the path to the new one. That sounds like it's working. And SDB. So I have both of the existing drives intact. I added the additional two drives to the mirror. So now I have a 4-wide mirror. This is going to force it to resilver and write data to both of the new disks, all 6TB of it, and it'll take a while. So I'm probably going to have to leave this overnight and come back to it. The advantage of doing it this way, instead of pulling one drive and swapping them one at a time, is I only have to do the resilver once instead of twice, and if there's any errors on the existing disks, both of them will still be there to read from and recover. There we go. So we now have that. We're resilvering. We have to do hella lots of resilver. I'm also going to set auto expand on for data pool. And this just means when I get rid of the smaller drives, it'll automatically fill the bigger ones. So resilver is going on, but I can still work on the local ZFS pool while that's happening. And actually, I can still work on the other pool too. So if I go here and we can add my new storage. So that's ZFS. It's called data. ZFS pool is data. Within provision, yes. I should have a new pool called data. So resilvering is in progress, so I don't want to mess with this too much. And I'm also going to go here and add my backup server. So local ZFS, that's now my 1TB mirror. Local is also 1TB mirror. Data is my Z pool that's like stupidly full. And Big Store is the backup server. So I can start restoring some VMs from backups. So let's take a look at the date and time that they did. Oh, it looks like one guy's doing backups right now. So Corona is going to be hard to restore, so we're going to deal with that one later. So I'm going to start restoring the rest of these. So Telstar is getting kind of big. I'm going to do something about that, but not today. Let's see. So he used to be CT102. He's going to stay 102. I'm going to copy everything else from backup and put him on local ZFS. Basically, this is how all of my VMs and containers are going to work. I'm going to go through their backups in the backup server, restore them under their same ID. The MAC addresses and IP addresses and stuff are all part of the VM's config, so that shouldn't change. And as soon as they start up, they should just be working as normal. The only exceptions to that are Iridium, my file server. I have to map all the mounts from the ZFS pool manually. I have a video on how I did that. And also my Frigate server, I didn't include the big drive in the backup. So I have to recover that because the 1 terabyte of security footage isn't worth backing up. So that's also on the Z pool. So I'm gonna wait for those two containers till my resilvering is done. So it is the next day. I now have a 4-wide mirror, 4 disks, all with identical data in ZFS. Time to remove the 2 6-terabyte disks to free up the space in my pool so I can get all my media off my SD card that I've been waiting to do for 3 days. So if I do ZFS list, you can see that data pool, we have 290 gigs available, which is not much. And also we have these 4 guys in the pool. So we're just gonna detach these guys. Copy him in. Did I spell it wrong? I spelled it wrong. There we go. Now we're down to 3 disks. So we do that again. And now we're down to SDNSDB. So if I ZFS list again, I should have more free space. And there we go, 9.38 terabytes free. So now I can get on with my life and start editing this video. It's the future, and my memory just arrived. So I bought a 32 gig kit of, what did I get? DDR5, 4800 megatransfers per second. Mediocre laptop RAM, I guess. 2 16 gig sticks, so I'll be at dual channel memory. Much better than at single channel. Also, for the past week or so, I've been roughing it without my Frigate server because I don't have enough memory to run that and everything else I'm doing. I'm getting out of memory errors a lot. So yeah, let's put this thing in. So here's the memory that came with the Ugreen. So it's 8 gigs, DDR5, 4800 megatransfers, Samsung. And I bought this stick to put in. So 16 gig DDR5, 4800, and I got 2 sticks. So I'll be dual channel. It is now the end of the video, and a careful observer might note, I don't have the NAS out here, I've got a bunch of other junk. So anyway, I put the 2 idsonix SSDs in, got the system running Proxmox, all well and good. I was like, you know, I'll just take some quick time to do some quick benchmarks, we'll be on the road. And oh boy howdy, those were fun. So my first benchmarking run resembled this. So I was not getting half of the advertised speed, but also the shape looked really wrong to me. So usually when you benchmark NVMe drives, the low like 4K randoms and stuff, like single queue depth, they're kind of really poor because that's what happens with single queue depth. You're based on latency, not bandwidth. But then it pretty quickly should ramp up to whatever the drive is capable of and just sit there flat. Or I guess the bandwidth of the interface. And so I knew it was negotiating PCIe Gen 4x4, as expected. So 16 giga transfers, 4 lanes. But I just wasn't seeing reasonable looking numbers. And a pretty big clue to me that something was off was that the CPU was pegging itself at about 18%. So the CPU in this Ugreen NAS is a Intel Pentium, and it has 4 E-cores and 1 P-core. So since I really needed my drives back up, I set the system up with 1 drive instead of a mirror, and took the other drive out and put it in this system to test. Now this system, it's coming in another video, but it has a Core i5. And what do you know? idsonix SSD tested just fine, the Core i5. I did a bit of an abbreviated test because each one of these data points is a 1 minute run, which is like 150 gigabytes to like a terabyte, depending on the bandwidth of that test. The data looks much better on this system with the Core i5. So the lesson I had was, even if your SSDs are blazing fast, your CPU may not be able to keep up, and probably can't keep up. Now there's a little more to that lesson though, because I was testing with FIO, Linux IO tester, and it was using libio, and I also tested with IOU ring, which is what QEMU uses. And so in that case, if you were running a user space app, it would be thread bound by the CPU. But ZFS should be able to make better use of it through its ZFS native queuing, the ZIO system. So maybe it would have done better with ZFS instead of just raw block device benchmark. But anyway, the drives I have are now perfectly adequate for the NAS I put them in. Not this one, but the one in the other room behind me. That NAS has been running for about 2 weeks now without issues. Both of the Z pools are perfectly happy, the SSD pool and the hard disk pool. My VMs are all happy. They have enough RAM. They're happy. And that Pentium CPU with 4 E-cores and 1 P-core is just fine for what I needed to do. So anyway, I have a link down below to the idsonix SSD. Thanks to them for sending them for this build. I also have links to the parts that I purchased as well, if you're interested in those. I did buy the hard drives refurbished on eBay, so I have a link to that as well if you're interested. If you want to chat with me on any of these things, I have a Discord server, link down below for that. A lot of fun. We talk about IPv6 and Proxmox and ZFS. If you are interested in tipping me, I would greatly appreciate it. Link down below to my Ko-fi for that. And as always, I'll see you guys on the next adventure.